Formula One Grand Prix magazine is brought to you by Elf.
Elf Oil, world champion.
Hello and welcome to Eurosport's Formula One Grand Prix magazine. The Japanese Grand Prix at Suzuka dominated by young German double world champion Michael Schumacher. So while John Watson and Ben Edwards prepare for the final Grand Prix on a beach somewhere in the Pacific, we'll take a long look back at Japan. So for the second time in 2 weeks, Japanese circuit played host to the Formula One circus. And for the fortunate few drawn from the massive numbers who apply for tickets, a chance to enjoy the spectacle of Formula One cars at speed. Here at Suzuka, a technical track, but fast and sweeping, where superb handling and raw power are the order of the day. And the public cheering on their heroes, Jean Alesi, and of course this man fighting his car through to an early lead in the qualifying, Michael Schumacher. First practice, no holds barred from Schumacher, intent on stamping his mark, his world champion status, grabbing pole position early on.
It's always a nice feeling. We're going to keep it tomorrow and as well go and win this race, which would mean we're going to win the Constructor Championship, which I'm looking forward to very much.
Behind Schumacher, arch-rival Damon Hill, the Germans... arch-rival ended his time on Friday, 1:39.032. Behind him, though... It was a return from Mika Häkkinen after surgery to an appendix operation, slightly tender, but just as quick as before.
Driving here today is not a problem. The car seat belts are not the problem. I show you protection. What we have put for the skin, which means the seat belts basically comes on top of that foam, and that's. Yeah, not too low. and that helps a lot. That helps a lot.
Alongside the Finn, Jean Alesi in the Ferrari, taking provisional pole at one stage in the qualifying session for a few moments, but still a good sign. The speed of the Ferrari leaves him optimistic for race prospects, a little better perhaps than they might have been expected at AIDA. David Coulthard unable to seize his fifth consecutive pole position. Don't forget Coulthard learning Suzuka for the first time. Mansell having raced the Williams last year in Japan and in Australia. Despite that, he was on pole until the final 15 minutes of Friday's qualifying session. And then as he watched from the pits, he saw the other drivers unseat him from his previously dominant position. Behind him, Heinz-Harald Frentzen wrung everything there was to wring out of the Sauber. And even he was optimistic of more time to come from the Ford-powered machine.
We are not 100% satisfied there. But I think also Gerhard Berger did only 4 laps today. And they can improve tomorrow and Saturday's qualifying a little bit. And it's going to be very tight anyway between position 5 and position number 10. It's very close, only hundreds of seconds away from the between the drivers.
So Saturday morning and a very tight battle in prospect for pole position. But before that, all eyes on Japanese driver Aguri Suzuki. After this high-speed accident, for some moments he remained in the car, surrounded by rescue and medical officials, trying to qualify for his 62nd Grand Prix. Coming down to the S's, he puts a wheel on the grass under braking, and that's all she wrote. Minor rib injuries and a bruised lung, but no back damage, despite the high-speed 130-mile-an-hour plus rearward impact, but certainly not the way he would have hoped to finish his Formula One career. After the drama then, world champion Michael Schumacher confirmed Friday's form to take his first pole since Canada in July. This 10th career pole position setting him up well for the all-important Constructors' Championship battle. As Flavio Briatore, the Benetton team boss, knows, it's going to be a tough fight with Williams. They won't want to hand it over after 3 years. Despite which, though, Briatore confirms the superiority of the Benetton. It's important, he says, that there are at least two or three cars between us and Hill. And a good chance on Saturday. Alesi in with a shot as well, confirming that with second fastest time, lining up alongside Shuey on the front row. And of course, these two swapping cars next year. It'll be interesting to see who gets the better of that deal. The Frenchman, though, does appear happy with his car, in high spirits. The only uncertainty covers the weather. He, at least, is hoping for rain. For the past 2 days, he says the car's handled extremely well, reliability is good as well, and tomorrow, from what he's heard, 60% chance of rain. If that happens, well, he won't be disappointed. But if the track's dry, he's still got plenty of slicks left to call on, so again, no problem. No matter what the conditions are, he will be giving it everything in his penultimate race for Ferrari. And behind him, Mika Hakkinen confirming Friday's form, as well as that returning him and the MP410 to the top orders. McLaren seems much happier in the fast corners here at Suzuka than it was in the tighter and twistier Aida circuit. The big surprise of the weekend, though, Hill and Coulthard well off the pace. The track clearly doesn't feature the Didcot team's cars. Now, the team seemed as surprised by that as everyone else, and it's bad news for the Williams duo, particularly in view of how strong the Benetton team are looking with a Constructors' Championship in view. And Gerhard Berger, having destroyed the balance of his Ferrari with an off from the first untimed session on Friday, struggles to play catch-up all the way through the qualifying. Despite being the tail-ender on the lead train of half a dozen cars, the Ferrari driver, like teammate Jean Alesi, remains in good spirits for prospects for the Japanese race.
Unfortunately, I'm the last of the group. There's 1.5 tenths difference between second and fifth, and I'm the last of the group, very, very close, especially on a long circuit like this. It's really surprising that we can be that close. I tried very hard. I had two good laps, and there was not more to in.
Well, we've become used now to seeing this man, David Coulthard, on pole position. Four successive poles, but not to be his fifth here at Suzuka. True, a lack of experience may have played some part in it, but clearly the car has its own part to play as well. Suzuka really seems to have robbed Williams of some of its mechanical advantage, and the race itself will only serve to confirm that trend. So the starting grid looks like this for Sunday's Japanese Grand Prix. Michael Schumacher on pole position in the Benetton, Alesi alongside in the Ferrari. And on row two, a very welcome return to form for Mika Hakkinen and the McLaren Mercedes. Damon Hill languishing in fourth slot in the Williams Renault. Gerhard Berger lines up behind Hakkinen, Coulthard behind his teammate in sixth. On the fourth row of the grid, Ulsterman Eddie Irvine flies the flag for Jordan ahead of Heinz-Harald Frentzen, going well in the Sauber. Johnny Herbert, the British driver in the Benetton in ninth, and Rubens Barrichello in 10th in the other Jordan. Olivier Panis looks good in 11th, Mika Salo alongside, Gianni Morbidelli and Ukyo Katayama making up row 7. Row 8, Carl Wendlinger and Pedro Lamy in the Sauber and the Minardi. Row 9, Luca Badua and Taki Inui. Row 10, Andrea Montermini and Paolo Pedro Diniz in the Pacific and the 40. Row 11, Bertrand Gachot behind Roberto Moreno, and Mark Blundell on his own on the final row of the grid. Didn't run on Saturday after damaging his hand in a crash. Back more with the result. A damp track greets the drivers as the red lights turn off and the green ones come on for the 16th and penultimate this year race of the season. A grueling 190-mile affair. A quick start from Eddie Irvine, but no change at the front. Schumacher zips into the lead ahead of Jean Alesi, Mika Hakkinen and Damon Hill say the grid positions remain, but first corner problems at the tail of the field for Gianni Morbidelli, tapped from behind by Carl Wendlinger, and Roberto Moreno fails to start. Gearbox problems dropped him into the pit lane after the formation lap, and he didn't leave it. At the end of lap one then, Irvine ahead of David Coulthard, but otherwise qualifying positions remain among the front runners. Alesi in second slot, not far behind the lead Benetton, but as Schumacher demonstrates, the track very slippery indeed, and the drivers certainly having anything but an easy time of it. In these conditions at more than 140 miles an hour, this is the sort of visibility the drivers have to contend with. Hill follows Häkkinen. Quite a surprise that, the Williams behind a McLaren and not lapping it, but Häkkinen hangs on there. At this stage, Hill playing his cards very tight to his chest. Controversy suddenly, Jean Alesi is pulled into the pits with a 10-second penalty for a jump start. The lights have caught him out once more. A little surprised by the penalty because starting in conditions like this on a downhill slope, he says it's very difficult to have a foot on the brake, one on the accelerator and also one on the clutch. Not forgetting this isn't a road car and they're starting with something like 15 or 16,000 RPM. He says it's just impossible to make sure the car is at rest all the time, particularly the way the clutch starts to drag on the line. Jean's not alone in his misfortune. He comes back out in ninth, far away from the leader he'd been tailing moments before. But to make matters worse, it's the other Ferrari which is hit with the same problem. Berger takes his turn to go in for the stop-go 10-second penalty, taking away any hopes for him of a good finishing position. But despite the bad luck, the Ferrari men are still in good form. Alesi at least working his way back up towards the lead group, running ninth and stuck in traffic behind Johnny Herbert. Finally, Max makes his way past and then heads for the pits, trading the wet weather tyres for slicks. A bold move and a gamble that seems likely to pay off. As the laps go by, Alesi starts to pick up speed, closing in on the leaders. Coming back out onto the track initially, though, he finds himself bottled up behind Pedro Lamy in a rather early and perhaps rather foolhardy effort to get past. Fortunately for Alesi, results in no damage at all to the car. But Jean Todt wonders what on earth might be going on in his driver's mind. Now the others start to dive into the pits for slicks too, and fuel as well, of course. Hill, one of the first in, and an exemplary pit stop from the Williams boys. No problems whatsoever. And proof, if proof were needed, that slicks are the right decision come immediately. Alesi tearing round the track on several occasions, putting up the fastest lap. And so the pit stops begin in earnest. Schumacher, taking no risks at all, waits to see the difference in lap times. Once Hill, his main rival, came back out, in he comes then for fuel and for tyres. And behind him, in comes Coulthard. So, change in the leading order. Schumacher in the pits, Häkkinen leads from Irvine, Hill and Alesi. Then the Frenchman and the Briton neck and neck. Alesi pulling off a stunning out-braking manoeuvre to go around the outside of Hill. This is the sort of manoeuvre that Alesi wins fans with, around the outside, under-braking into the chicane on cold, damp tyres, on a cold, damp track. Häkkinen and Irvine, the two leaders, arrive together. And as Häkkinen blitzes out of the pits again on stone-cold tyres, effectively on this damp surface off the racing line, he's very gingerly finding his way around the first couple of corners. Meanwhile, Alesi almost back within striking distance of leader Schumacher, and after the chaos of the first group of pit stops, it's these two drivers who are the real focus of attention. Third at this stage, Damon Hill, then Häkkinen, Irvine and David Coulthard in sixth position. So the Williams boys really out of the running at the moment. Speaking of which, Ukio Katayama cuts Japanese involvement in the race to just 50% of its starting numbers, spinning out, unable to rejoin. Just over 3 seconds now, separating Alesi and Schumacher as Alesi puts in yet another group of fastest laps, really getting his head down. Meanwhile, the battle for fifth hotting up. This is Barrichello, out braking himself, chasing teammate Eddie Irvine. Brazilian trying just that little too hard.
Yeah, it was the only point that I could overtake Eddie. So Coulter, I was on the same pace as Coulter, and Eddie was a little bit slower at that point, so I was trying really to overtake him. But unfortunately, he was a little quicker on the straight. So when I came before to the King, I did it very quick, but I put the wheel on the wet. So by the time that I went braking, I lost completely because I had no grip at all.
Retirement two for Berger, yet again a victim of engine problems. Exactly the same ignition problem that we saw four races ago. Berger not happy with the unreliability of seemingly only his Ferrari. And an ambitious move goes wrong for Heinz-Harald Frentzen, locked up on the inside, down inside Eddie Jordan. Irvine spun out in the Jordan, and the Sauber heading for the pits. Irvine fortunate to sustain no damage there. A new nose, though, goes onto the Sauber. And the battle between Alesi, there he is, and Schumacher ahead continues. Alesi really running a stunning race, attacking hard at every possible opportunity whenever it presents itself. As he says after the race, I jumped on every chance to come back and grab a position which he felt had been his from the start. Also, he knew that Schumacher was within his reach. Maybe he couldn't have passed him, but he was going to give it everything he had anyway, particularly after such a disappointing start. And the only real danger for Schumacher at Suzuka did come from Alesi, but for the 10-second penalty at the start and that spin after the attack on Pecco Lamy, maybe the Ferrari driver might have engineered a very different scenario. After the race, Schumacher admits only to have seen red in his rear vision mirrors. But for Alesi, well, he's soon to see smoke pouring from the back of the Ferrari. The number 27 car's motor parks him prematurely at the end of the road. Once more, the V12 reduces the number of running components to less than the requisite, and the disappointment written all over Jean Alesi's face, if not perhaps quite so visible on that of team manager Jean Todt. So the battle for second place is wide open, and while the Ferrari is being parked on the grass, Schumacher comfortably leads now from Damon Hill. Then comes Hakkinen, Coulthard, Irvine, and Johnny Herbert. And in a return to some sort of the form that he showed in 1994, but which has really eluded him this year, Olivier Panis is looking towards championship positions. The bottom of the top six, his target. Second and last stop, meanwhile, for Schumacher, allowing Hill at least temporarily to take the lead while the German is at rest. But it's going to be a short-lived run in the lead if Schumacher has anything to do with it. Out he comes, running up into third position behind the McLaren of Mika Hakkinen. Time then for Hill to make his second and final stop, and any advantage that he might have eked out, well, can the Williams team add to it? No, they can't. Not enough at any rate, and Schumacher is clear as Hill comes back onto the track in second place. And at this point, it's unlikely that anything bar mechanical disaster is going to slow the German in his quest for the constructors' title. With less than 20 laps to go, everything seems to be falling into Benetton's lap, which is more than you can say for some drivers. Pedro Diniz off the circuit in the 40, and as a result of the oil that he's laid down, Damon Hill goes for a spectacular slide off, through and across the gravel traps. But Hill is not out of the race. The off-roading hasn't done much for the underside of the Williams, but he does continue to the pits at least. Mark Blundell also caught by surprise. And having got through safely the first time he met the oil, David Coulthard goes rally crossing on the very next lap.
I came round the corner and the track was slippy and I went off. And I go through the gravel and come back on, and then there's a marshal with the yellow and red flag to say it's slippy. So it was too late, my mistake, and there you go.
And then a few moments later, spectacularly, he crashed out of the race.
When I braked for the fast corner, all the gravel came out of my pods and I spun in my own gravel.
Another victim of the oil slick, Heinz-Harald Frentzen finding himself in trouble. So once more, it's back to the Sauber pit for a new nose, particularly since this one is shedding bits left, right and centre. More problems for the Williams team. Hill is handed a stop-go penalty for speeding on his second pit stop. But this weekend in Japan is not to be Damon's. He doesn't even get back to the pits to pick up the penalty. Once more, caught out on the spoon corner. This time not on the oil, but on dirt left by other cars.
Well, I went in there and I just understeered straight on. I mean, the first experience I had of it was I went straight in there about two laps after my pit stop. I turned in, I got understeer and went straight off, and then I came back on, and then they changed it. I went out there, did one more lap, and they had the oil flags out, but I thought it was raining. And when it stopped raining, I went in there, and then it was oil, and I went off on the oil. But there was oil, I think, because it was... I was coming in on for a penalty. I got a penalty on top of everything. I got a penalty for going too fast in the pit lane.
Insult added to injury for Damon Hill. Some contrast between his fortunes and those of the leader, Michael Schumacher. We'll be back in the moment with the top six result. Welcome back then. Sixth across the line of the Japanese Grand Prix, the man who made his Grand Prix debut a year before at the Suzuka Circuit.
I like this type. I hope more races would be like this. But then there's always guys like Inoue. He held me up for 20 laps and he was 2 seconds a lap slower than me, and I just couldn't get by because I was so slow on the straights. And he was really, it looked like he was trying to block me and I was lapping him. I don't understand these type of things, and just maybe next year regulation, get the big mirrors for some guys.
So sixth for Mika Salo, and finally a good result for Olivier Panis, fifth championship points in Japan for him and for Ligier. Very difficult race, he says, for Mugen Honda. Very important Grand Prix for them as well, of course, to finish in the points. And perhaps some reward for what's been a difficult season. But to win points on home ground for Mugen was very important. They're very happy, and so he hopes it'll motivate them to make a better engine for him next year. Eddie Irvine smiling as well, despite a fairly torrid race in the Jordan. Bringing it home, though, in a remarkably good fourth position, considering the incidents that he sustained.
It was not boring, for sure. Rubens, I think, was behind me, and I was in big trouble with understeer because I start on full wet settings because I think it's going to rain again, and I think he just lost the brakes and he spin, and he hit the back of my car, but no damage, and then Frentzen tried to overtake, but didn't quite make it, and we touched, and I spin again, but I keep going and I make it to the finish.
Johnny Herbert completes a successful weekend for Jordan with a podium that he might have thought was beyond his reach. The team savours its success as he crosses the line.
It's good, you know, getting the constructors finished here in Japan, you know, especially for Mild 7, and then giving myself a chance of finishing third again in the championship. So it's very good going into the next race in Adelaide.
15 days after going under the surgeon's knife, Häkkinen secures runner-up spot. Perhaps you ought to have a few more operations.
And slowly, you know, the development comes. But like, you know, I'm already set my mind for this year 100%. I'm concentrating for next year 100% at the moment. I'm just driving now in the terms to develop for the engine and the chassis.
But the real master of the conditions, Schumacher again, equaling the record of victories of one season, 9 by Nigel Mansell, and the constructors' title going to Benetton after 3 years of Williams domination.
To drive a race like this, win the constructor championship for the team is just fantastic.
Everyone of the team made a fantastic job.
Yeah, all the year. I mean, they never made one mistake, and it's going to be tough to race against them next year to beat them.
A double celebration then for Benetton this season, winning the Drivers' and Constructors' Championships, and perhaps the icing on the cake, third place for Johnny Herbert in the overall championship, ahead of Coulthard and Alesi. Well, that'll all be decided at the final race in Australia. We'll say goodbye to Adelaide then, and to the 95 Formula One season in 10 days' time here on Eurosport. See you then. Bye for now.